From the Endergrove Remains production team studios in the Netherlands, my name is Mixmaster G and welcome to this unannounced, unscheduled live stream. My mission is not to sell you as many apps as I can. No, my mission is to educate and teach you about collection management and conversion with DJs, so you save yourself more time for the fun and creative part of being a DJ. This is once again my workflow stream. And that means that I'm just going to do what I always do when I want to update my collection with new tracks. And I show it all to you guys so you can see what I'm doing and get pointers from that, how to do it in your own workflow. Of course, the chat will be open for any questions you may have. And I will answer them, of course, if I can. If they are very complex, the questions, then I will delay them for my normal regular Ask Me Anything streams, which are Tuesday evenings at 7 o'clock European Standard Time. So please save them for that. But if you just have a quick question, there will be a lot of waiting in this workflow, then I'm totally here to help you out with anything I can. So the chat is there. Say hi if you like to, and just enjoy the ride. The first part is, for those who are not familiar with my workflow, my tracks are stored on an AppleShare file server. That sounds very complicated, but just think about it as a giant external drive. One of the benefits of having that is, first of all, it's very easy for me to back it up, because just back up the file server, I get all my audio tracks in the backup. All the computers that are in my network are connected to it. So I don't have to have all the tracks on those separate computers. They just access it all from a central storage location, which saves, of course, a lot of time. And last but not least, it is just convenient. If that file server dies, then I just take an external backup by the same name, connect it to a computer, and the computer doesn't know the difference. It wouldn't tell if it's working from the file server or from an external drive. It's all the same to that computer. So in case of emergencies, it's very easy to recover. So those are my main reasons why I do it like this. But again, if you just use an external drive or another file server, you've got the same situation. You don't have the same situation if you use cloud services, because cloud services are basically a duplicate or a synchronize or a copy of a local folder on your computer. So no matter if stuff is in the cloud, it will also be on your local computer, meaning you need to have a hard drive big enough to store it all, and you must be willing to let it sync up and down all the time, and that makes life a little bit slower. So for those reasons, I like to do it my way. But again, I'm not claiming that I have the perfect one-size-fits-it-all solution for you. I just do it my way for my reasons, but maybe you do it your way for your reasons, and that's fine. I'm just explaining why I do it the way I have it. First of all, my tracks are in iTunes, which is my, I call that collection management software, and you can see it right here. But I seem to have a little bit of a problem with, there it is, with my remote. I use this little USB keypad to switch scenes in OBS. Look, you can just, without, no hands, mom. You can just do it like that. But sometimes it loses connection, or it doesn't know where it's at. So you saw that at the beginning of this stream, then it loses the connection. I cannot switch screens. Another thing, please, sometimes I know myself, in the heat of the moment, I forget to switch screens. Why is that? Because basically I'm just doing my stuff. So I'm seeing a big screen with a camera above it, and that's it. And I've got a second screen where I see what OBS is doing, but I'm not paying too much attention to that. I must be honest with that. And I've got on the other side, my MacBook for all your commands through the chat, but I'm paying attention to the commands, but not necessarily to what is on the screen streamed. So please, if you see some discrepancies there, if you see that I'm not switching screens while I expect to switch screens, just yell it at me in the chat, and I'm happy to just switch the screens. With no further ado, let's go, because this is going to be a long one, folks. This is where I want to be at. Let me quit iTunes here. And I didn't, of course. That's a little bit. I forgot to switch my screen. Normally, I use a 9020 by 1080 screen during my streams. And I'm going to do that right now, live, while you watch it. The reason for that, because then I see what you see. And now I see more than you see, which means sometimes you will miss something out. So let me get my 9020 by 1080 screen up so you can see what I'm doing. Hold on. Don't you love this live streaming? And don't you love it when you don't do it prepared at all? It's a good thing that I'm wearing a wireless mic because I can keep talking, but I can imagine that I have to go to the toilet during this stream. And then, of course, it would be better if I mute it. So we'll see how that will work. But hey, I'm just trying my best here, folks. So I hope that is a little bit appreciated. Let me find the connector that's there. Let me put the cam back on top of it. There it is. So great that you can do this real time these days with an HDMI connection. I'm from the days that all displays had their very own proprietary connection. There was no way you could do this shit. You need to power down the computer. Then you could switch screens, because otherwise you either blow up your graphic card or other more serious stuff would happen. Look, this is my entire screen with everything on it, as you can see. For instance, I don't need the prototype because I was doing some interesting yet secret stuff. So I just eject that. If it will eject it. Yeah, eject them all, please. And let's see what else we've got. And please forget, or please talk to me in the chat. Then I know that people are watching, and some interaction is always nice, especially during those very dull times. This was the Prutz drive. So nothing there. All right, first step. I like to use the Denon Prime SC6000M as my preferred performance platform, which means I'm just jamming away on that particular platform. It is right next to me. I didn't hook up the cam, but for those who want to see it, I think the overhead cam will show it. You see it right there, that it is. And I'm just jamming away usually on it. For now, I'm just practicing my scratching to get it a little bit up to speed, because these are 6000 amps. That means that, well, you better scratch on them because they have a turning platter. But I'm nowhere near a turntablist or a real scratcher. So it's real practicing for me. Which also means that sometimes I set new cues and loops on those drives. And of course, I want to have those cues and loops back in my big collection, which is a Traktor collection. And I've got the tools to get the cues I set on there in Traktor. And that's not possible with anything else but my tools. Hydrate in time, especially when the heater is on, because otherwise you get a sour throat in no time. Here we are. This, show that in front of you guys, is the drive I usually use on the 6000 amps, and that has the cues and loops I set on it. And now I have no idea which playlist they are. I have no idea which tracks I used, but there is some magic involved that will automatically sort that out for me. And that magic is called history lists. The moment you are on a Prime deck and a track is playing for longer than 20 seconds, then that particular track will be stored in a history list. So basically the history list has every track I played with the cues and the loops I might have deleted, added, I don't know. We'll see that in a moment. So what I do is I get that information, and for that I use the Denon extractor tool. There it is. And the Denon extractor tool automatically recognizes the Prime drive, as you can see right there. I could go from Dropbox, but this is just Prime drive related. It uses the iTunes collection tool, as you can see right there. The iTunes collection tool, I dive into that more later on, but it's basically a tool I developed that uses audio fingerprinting to recognize tracks, and that is used to make sure that I don't have any duplicates in my iTunes base collection. Very interesting stuff, will be shown later on. What is interesting for me is I will switch off the clear history playlist and I want to clear the preparation playlist, because after this conversion I don't want to have any history lists on that drive anymore. So the next time I use that particular drive, it will make a new history list, a new preparation list, and just go back or start up from there. I don't need any playlists from it. All I need is the history and the preparation playlist, because those are the target playlists containing the tracks of my current interest, because this is conversion back from Prime to my Traktor collection. Just 6 tracks, as I see. Like I told you, it wasn't much. I did this fairly recently, so. And it's backing up right now, so that will take some time just to back up all the data. And again, folks, don't forget, if you like to say something, leave it in the chat. I don't see anything happening at the Restream chat at the moment. Let me double check that on my normal Twitch thingy to see if that's correct. Because maybe it's just quiet and nobody's watching or some other information. You are live. Click the avatar. Yep. And then, no, there's no activity in the feed. All right. Well, that's fine. Then we should be good with that. As far as I can see. All right. But at least it tells me that I'm live. That's at least a plus. And I still have to wait for the backup to finish. The backup is just a precaution because, like you saw, it will... Ah, Mark McGeer. Thank you. At least I know that the stuff is working and that it is showing on Facebook. Because Mark is on Facebook, as far as I can see. I love this Restream stuff. It's so convenient for me. Like I was telling you, it is need to make a backup, because after it has done its magic, it will delete the history and preparation list from that drive's Prime collection. And before I always delete anything, I'm very happy to just make sure that there is a backup in case whatever goes wrong. There's not much I know that can go wrong. I never needed my backups anyway, but I know of some artists who really needed them. Most of the time because they yanked their Prime 4 out of the computer or switched it from controller to standalone mode without unmounting it from the desktop first. And in that case, it's almost guaranteed that your drive will be dead. So for that, and I forgot to switch my screen. I warned you guys about it. I will forget to switch my screen all the time. So you have no idea what I'm talking about. And I think, hey, those guys can see this all. So, again, this will happen a lot, folks. It's, I know myself, it's just sloppiness or call it being up in what I'm doing or invested in what I'm doing instead of paying attention or being a director of my own show. I think I should have mods one of these days. Maybe I know some people who might be interested in becoming a mod on my channels. But they must be ready to be bored to death, because sometimes my streams are just plain boring, let's face it, because the stuff I'm doing or involved in is most of the time very boring and not of everybody's interest. But if anybody is up for becoming a mod, just yell out to me on Facebook or send me a whisper on Twitch, and I'd be happy to take that into account, because I think I can use a mod. And usually my girlfriend Yvette was doing the moderation, but that basically came down to making sure that there were no assholes posting stuff in the chat that I didn't want in the chat. I seem to be cleared of that pretty well, because my channel is not that big. So if you want to spam, my channels are not the proper place to spam at all. So that's why there is not much going on there. But I can imagine that for other people, mods are necessary, and for me mods are necessary because I forget to switch screens. Text is finished. It has converted the tracks we need. That means that in the ATR production team folder, within the documents folder, there is a record block text created. That is the one you see there highlighted. If I want to know what has happened, then I can read it here and you can see right there some stuff has happened. I'm not going into that full speed. I just want to know that that worked okay, which means I can fire up the DJ conversion utility, which just had a flaming review, or actually an article, by Digital DJ Tips. Thank you very much, folks, for covering the stuff I do and supporting it about the conversion from DJ. But this time around, we go from a Recordbox XML. That is the Recordbox XML produced by Text. And you can see right here that it is automatically selected. And I want to go to Traktor, because Traktor is my performance platform. Before I do that, I need to have it enabled. So basically, this is how we roll. And we wait for it to finish. Here are the history lists, and you can see there are three history lists, or four actually, by double name. That's weird, but I don't mind. Mark, always, never a problem. You can always ask me stuff if you want to. Indeed, it's better if you do that if it's a complex question, it's better to do that in a private mail or in a direct mail. Otherwise, you can just throw it in the chat. It depends on the complexity of what you need to know. But most of my shit is really quickly answered. And for most of my tutorials I've got, or for most of my apps, I've got tutorials. But you're more than welcome for this. Mario G, by the same name. Mixmaster G, Mario G. Thank you very much, my friend. And have a great, great 2021. Happy New Year. So, where am I? Oh, I run the DJ conversion utility, and you can see it was done. And it is starting up Traktor already. Now, because I have my tracks on the terabyte, on the external drive, Traktor takes close to forever to start up. On this very fast computer I am right now, it will take like 7 minutes or something like to start up. The trick for that is just to eject the drive, the terabyte, as you saw me just ejecting, from the host computer and then starting up Traktor. It will speed it up. Main reason is this collection is 120,000 tracks big. And mind you, that takes a long time to start up. So by doing it like this, you make sure that it gets a little bit faster, and it should be, there it is, a little bit faster indeed. Of course, as soon as it is done, I need to establish it again. Now, here's the trick, folks. I can eject the prime drive. Remember, this was coming. These were tracks that I played with on my prime gear. Because I played with it on my prime gear, usually if you convert it back, that means that you need the drive that was connected to the prime gear for this to work. However, and that's the beauty of the Denon extractor tool, it will find the original tracks. So it finds the tracks on the terabyte. That was the reason why I was doubting, should I eject it already? Oh no, I can't. Because if we look right here in the DJ conversion utility, this is the new one. This is the prime drive we worked from. These are the history lists. It are three after all. And there we have the tracks. And you see duplicates, because usually, like I told you guys, I was experimenting with getting my scratch skills a little bit up. So, whoa, you say overmodulated. I was working to get my scratch skills up, and that means that I have the same track on two decks. That's the reason why there are duplicates there. But there are not duplicates in my collection. There are just singles in my collection. Only in the public, in the playlist, they show up as duplicates. You can see those are exactly the things I expected to be there. This is a fun track, folks, because you all know Watch Out for This by Major Lazer. This is the original. The original of Watch Out for This by Major Lazer was a track by a guy named Typhoon and the New Cool Collective. Actually, it was the New Cool Collective and the Flexicon who made it. But it's a great track. And it was Dutch from origin, so I like to play a little bit with it. And everybody knows this, of course. All that stuff is set, not that, but... Oh, there was nothing set there actually by the players, but here you can see it in the names of the cues. You see that? That means that particular cue was set on the deck. So if you go a little bit further, you can see right there that that is all set on the Denon deck. And I see a little bit of a shift there. That might be because the encoder correction is wrong. It might be on purpose. I really don't know what I did there. That's always, and here we've got. You see there the name Dext Q. That means it was set by Dext. And usually I delete the rest of it, but obviously I didn't delete it. That loop was set also on the Denon Prime deck. So that's how I get my stuff I did over the week back into my Traktor main collection. Pedro, what's up, buddy? Shout out to Pedro Estrada and happy 2021, my friend. Always good to see you on here for a moment. Nice to see you all on, by the way. Thank you. Thank you for participating in this. It's always something new for me to check this out. All right, that means that my preparations of what I had done in the previous days is all back inside my Traktor collection, which I wanted. And I can now focus on adding new tracks. And here the real boring stuff starts. So you be warned. I told you in this before, it will get boring at some time. And this is that time that it gets boring, really. But we try to keep to make this as fun and as entertaining as humanly possible. So let's wait for record or Traktor to actually finish. Warned you, this takes close to forever. By the way, the same thing as with opening Traktor is with closing Traktor. If you know what you are doing, just eject the external drive that contains your tracks. This process will be a lot faster. But I forgot that. I can try it right now, but I'll most likely complain. Oh, not necessary anymore. All right, here we are. Clean slate. Nothing there. What are we going to add? First of all, I've got some hardstyle stuff I need to add. I'm not really a hardstyle fan. Not at all. Not even into the slightest. But hardstyle in the Netherlands is really big. So basically, my apprentices like to use hardstyle tracks sometimes. I really cannot stand it. I'm a soul, hip-hop, disco, funk guy, and not hardstyle, but hey, you know. Then I've got a Houdini vinyl, which I just ripped because I came to my disgrace, or I saw that I don't have any Houdini tracks in my digital collection. I have it on vinyl, so I needed to rip that, and I need to convert that up to my iTunes collection. So that needs to be added as well. Mind you, this is still WAV. I never use WAV, I use MP3s, which means I have to convert that as well. You will see how I convert it. But in Tuesday's stream, I will go deep into why I use MP3s, why I convert them the way I convert them, whether is that the best way to convert or not. It will be all about that stuff. Basically, audio file types for DJs and all you need to know about it, because it's not as plain cut as you might hope it would be. But more about that Tuesday. And then I've got the top 40 stuff. So my mother always teaches me, let's start with the hard stuff first. And that means we start with the art style stuff. I start up the iTunes collection tool, which is right there. And the iTunes collection tool is, like I told you, the tool that will get new tracks, or basically will make sure that you don't have any duplicates in your iTunes collection, and it uses audio fingerprinting for it. For that we need the add new tracks, and then I need to tell it which folder it's going to work from. I thought I made this drag and drop, but obviously I did not, which is fine because then we go it like this. We have the QDance art style folder. I want to add this. This is from December 2020, as you saw, which means I will add it to the Dance EDM by year and to the Dance 2020, like that, playlist. Because I've used the Dance 2020 playlist before, you see it right here that it is connected, selected. Because I used it before, it knows that it needs to store them on the terabyte in which folder. You will see with the Houdini track, which doesn't know where to store its shit, that I have to specify that. And finally, there is an overflow folder there. Basically, let's go. And if we open this folder, you will see that tracks slowly disappear from that particular folder. You open it. And then you can see it disappearing. There's always, the finder always takes some time to get acquainted about, or to see what's going to happen. And you can see right there that it is moving the tracks to the final destination. That's what you see happening, because it's going from an entirely different drive to the terabyte drive. That's done. Then the iTunes collection tool should go into the next phase, but I don't know where it went with its user interface. Ah, there it is. This is the phase where it is creating an audio fingerprint of all the newly added tracks, which are 40 tracks, because it was a top 40, so 40 tracks. But most likely of those 40 tracks, a majority of it will be already in the iTunes collection, because it was just an update. And it will find what is in, what is not, and then make the results out of it. Let's see. I warned you guys, this will be very boring. In the meantime, I can answer an email question. That's a new one. I've got someone here who just bought the DJ conversion utility. Always interesting new ones. And he cannot open the file, which is logical, because if I'm reading this correct, he doesn't have a macOS computer. He has only an iPad and an iPod. That's a new one. I get fairly a lot of people with Windows computers, but not with that. So that would be a new one. Let's see what the iTunes collection tool has done, shall we? Because it's finished. Right here, if you go to the collection or to the songs view, which is my favorite view, and then you sort it on data, this is the stuff that is added. And it are 39 tracks. Basically, one track was already my collection. Or something, no, it was already in my collection. The next step for me is to get rating, to give rating to those. And that's most easiest done if I just temporary dump collection, remove the songs. Remember, removing songs from a playlist doesn't remove it from your collection, it just removes it from that particular playlist. So here we've got the new tracks. You can see none of them has a rating, and now the fun really begins. I start up Quicksilver. Quicksilver is a free app that helps you to create shortcuts. So you can just define shortcuts for it. And the iTunes collection tool, the thing you just saw me using for adding new tracks, comes with a bunch of shortcuts I created for you. One of those shortcuts is setting star ratings to tracks. And another shortcut is moving forward and backward in the track that is playing. So let's start this track. I should put it a little bit louder, I think. Like I told you guys, I'm not using the mouse, as you can see. The mouse pointer stays at the play. I'm only using the shortcuts I created for this. It's just going to the next track. For those who are wondering, what do your star ratings mean? 3 stars to me is, first of all, star ratings is how likely will I use a track in a set. And with this kind of music, 3 stars means I might use it, I might not use it. Anything below 3 is not very likely. 4 and 5, the higher, the better. In this particular playlist, I just created, anything with lower than 3 stars, so 2 or 1, will be deleted as soon as I'm done. So I will remove those tracks. I will remove them from the terabyte because it doesn't make any sense to keep them in my playlists because they are big enough as they are already. So that's how I use them. Let me continue with this. The bell you hear, it means there are no more tracks without a rating set. I just sort it on rating now and select all the tracks with 2 stars. And then I press Shift F1, which will invoke yet another Quicksilver script that comes with the iTunes collection tool that will remove them, which will deep remove them. So show that to you guys, why not? Show it in the Finder. And keep an eye out on that sick mode ruler track. Oh, it was removed already. All right, faster than you can think, right? But that is how it works. You see it removing more tracks like that. So basically, maybe the easiest way to show that is right. This should be right now 32 tracks. Indeed, it is 32 tracks. So that's how this stuff works, folks. You can see that those shortcuts can be huge, huge, huge time savers, because it very quickly enables you to do this kind of stuff. Next up is I want those tracks to be added to my hardstyle folder and to my techno folder. I'm not really a genre purist. Some of the tracks felt more like trance tracks, but I don't care. So I just put them in the right playlist. So right now they are in the techno playlist as well. If I sort it on date, then we see them all on top. And that is how I process those tracks. Next up, why not? Let's do the let's do the Houdini thing, which needs some processing because those are, like I told you, WAFs. And that, let me do that very quickly. Go to iTunes and we put them in the dump folder. The dump folder is basically, or the dump playlist. The dump playlist is basically always my thing where I test stuff out. Hey, Jeroen. JWG. Yeah, that's correct. That's also with a G. So we had Mario G, and now we have JWG. Sounds like we've got a lot of G's in the house, right? Welcome to the stream, buddy. that's funny. I can appreciate a little bit of humor. All right. As you can see, right there, we've got the tracks in, and you can see that they are named by where they came from the final. So let's first edit that out. And I, like I said, I do all this stuff. Basic collection management is done in iTunes. So that's why I do it like this. Maybe it would be a better idea to do this, or to convert it first to MP3. I'm halfway now. Why not? You can see this isn't too difficult because I'm going to batch name them Artist Houdini later on. I'm going to give them the proper artwork, and then I'm all set with it. That last one already. You see, they are all there now. I use iTunes as my program to convert from WAF or AF to MP3, because it is the best program for that. Again, reasons for that will be in Tuesday's stream, which we go deep diving into audio formats and why I do shit the way I do it. For now, let me just show you what I do. I don't want VBR on. I don't want smart recording, joint stereo, or now just put on normal, please. Channels auto, sample rate auto, that is all fine. As you can see, you have to search in iTunes to find these settings. By the way, if you are on the music app on Catalina, these settings are there as well, only you have to find them in a different spot. But once you have seen this, it works the same. And then we say, let's convert them. And I always have to find where the convert is. Oh, there's the convert. That didn't go too that wasn't too much of a thing. And let's, you can see it's converting right there. You see it right here at the top of the screen. And you will not see any converted tracks appearing. But they are there. First things first, I can remove this stuff from my iTunes collection now because I don't need the WAVs anymore, which means Shift F1 and it will be gone. Again, this is the same one I used, the same shortcut I used to remove those two-star rating tracks from my collection. Now, if I go to the song level again, then we got right here the MP3s. And I want those inside my let me put them in there, like this. And you can see those are MP3s. Then I'm going to delete these things because I don't need them anymore. Because I'm going to re-add them again, but this time around, we add them as a WAV. Oh my god, this is why I want to have mods on my channel, because sometimes you get people you don't want to be them to be. So let's see if I can do this manually. Be able to do. There it is. Can I bend that or something? Be able to bend it. And reply to it. That's not what I want to do. Not very good in this with this. There it is. See if this works. Sorry folks, I'm fairly new to streaming on Twitch, so seem to have worked. Yeah, it has worked. Yay! One message was even deleted by a moderator. That's me. Haha. I've got the power. Okay. Lesson learned. I can do that as well. I can just delete shit from Twitch. I'm a quick learner. All right, back to the subject. So I've got the Houdini LP, the Houdini there, and I want to put that on the terabyte. So let's create something new, and that is called Diverse Albums. And because we are in New Year. In the year 2021, as you can see. And then we create, hold on, open it up, create a new folder, because this will be the destination folder for the new stuff. Cover art, etc., will be later on. The same within my iTunes collection, through with this, through with that. We have the albums. We create a new folder because it's a new year. Why not? Like that. That's a new folder. That is going to be the target folder, and there we create a new playlist, and this playlist is named like that. So basically, I'm all set and ready to receive the new tracks in this particular playlist. So let's do that. Start up the iTunes collection tool again. And folks, this is all preparing to get my stuff, my new tracks into iTunes. before I can convert anything, because conversion is basically the easiest part of the whole workflow. Just to get it all up and running. It's like painting a house. The preparations before the painting are more work than the actual painting. The sandpapering and cleaning and God know what is much more work. We are coming from this particular folder. I can take the folder like there. We want to add it to the Houdini playlist, which we just created. I want to move the audio files to on the terabyte. Folder, and that's basically all I need to set. Next time I'm going to do a Houdini 1983 album, it will automatically find those settings. For now, this is what we need to set. Go for it. And like you saw before, it will copy the tracks from the source folder right there to the terabyte. Then it will create an audio fingerprint on it. Then it will check that the tracks are not in my collection, and then it will add them to the designated playlist. If the tracks are in my collection, then the found track will be added to the playlist. So that playlist will always be 8 tracks long, no matter what happens. There's a lot of intelligent shit going on in the back of this app. I can tell you that. I'm still looking at that guy who tells me, all right, I know it's macOS, and I don't have a macOS computer, only iOS. I know it's confusing. Thank you, Apple, for that. But iOS and macOS are two different operating systems. That's basically how it works. All right. Ice tea is done. I don't need to see the log. I always want to see the results. There we are in iTunes with the results. I have to finish up. I'm cleaning, as you know, because these are not set the way I want them to be. So first of all, the artist of this is Houdini. The album is a final rip. The year is 1983, I think. Yeah, that makes sense, Peter. Top up there. Three, and let me find the cover art. No, I don't need to open that. Well, it was easier if I went through. But there we go. Processing. All done. Yay, we've got somebody who bought something from me. Could set that off. That means I had to close mail, and I want to see what's going on. So you can see that it is still happening here. Open kimono, I told you about that. Don't you love that old 80s hip-hop vibe? It's so great. So yay, finally we've got Houdini in the house, and Houdini as a track right there. So Houdini has been added. That can be taken from my list as well. Bye. Then we've got the top 40 2021, and you can see it's week 1 and week 2, which means we don't have a top 40 2021 playlist. So it's basically the same thing I did with the Houdini playlist. I create a new playlist, and it's called top 40 2021. Sorry, I cannot make this more interesting than that. It's an empty playlist. You cannot change the view if there is no audio in it. That's just a restriction of our friends from iTunes. So I cannot move that or do that right now. So that's need to be done later on when the tracks are added. I can quit iTunes at this stage because ICT will automatically open iTunes later on. Then we go to my top 40 collection. There we make a brand new folder named Top 40 2021. Again, I cannot make it any more interesting than that. This is how it works. So we have a Top 40 2021 playlist. We fire up ICT again. And we nip our drinks. Yay. Of course, need to hydrate. And we add new tracks, and the new tracks are this time coming from desktop folder and the music stuff, top 40 stuff, and I can just take the entire top 40 stuff folder. We are going to add it to an existing playlist, which is the top 40 2021 folder, like that. And we are going to browse to the destination folder, which I should have done through the terabyte like that, but it will work as well. There we are. So you can see right there that everything is filled in. The next time I'm going to add top 40, 21 new entries. I don't have to jump through all the hoops because the moment I say the top 40, 2021 playlist is the destination, ICT knows automatically where it needs to be stored, etc. One of the beauties of this whole workflow, try to make it as much automated as possible so you can be saved as much time as possible. I had 20 tracks, but odds are high that most of the tracks are already there because top 40 tracks usually enter my playlist as a tipper rate track. So they are most of the time already there unless it comes into the top 40 without being ever into the tipper rate, which is also a possibility, of course. And that is why it's so important to have this functioning audio fingerprinting, because that will tell you if the track is already there or not. And if you just use your regular sources and buy it from your regular record pools, you always have the same audio fingerprint. The vinyl rip I just made is tricky because I made it and the audio fingerprint might differ from Houdini tracks that were already in my collection. I'm aware of that. So that's always a little bit of a thing to keep in mind. And of course, if you've got questions for me, because I've warned you guys, there will be a lot of waiting involved in this particular workflow video, then just drop them into the chat and I'm very happy to address them wherever I can. Always curious what I sold, so let's see what I sold. Oh yay, a rack. That's going to the United Kingdom. Why not? Welcome to the club, my friend. ICT is finished, so the message for that, that means we can go inside here, and this time I can change the view and now it will stay there. And you see those star ratings that are already there with the comment fields that are filled already there. That means those tracks were already in the collection and found. So basically, like I told you, that's the beauty of ICT. If it finds the tracks, then it will replace them, etc. So those tracks are already there, so those are good to go. We got Big Brother again on television in the Netherlands. It's a new thing, so they took the biggest female singer of the moment, which is Davina Michelle in the Netherlands, and let her make a new record. So if you see that, hey, what the heck is going on there? That's going on. And I don't like the new Harry Styles record. It has too high a Mika sound to it, and I love Mika because he was original. But Harry Styles has its own sound, so maybe I get acquainted with it. That's the beauty of my star systems. Star ratings can change over time, so maybe I get acquainted with it. But right now, I'm not there. And you could also see that the shortcuts automatically skip tracks that already have a rating. So you only set ratings at the tracks that don't have a rating yet. And that's why this works so well for me, to very quickly set the ratings on the top 40 tracks. Which means all my new tracks are added to iTunes and all those new additions have a rating. So most of the manual labor is done. And I can quit iTunes again. Because what I want to do is I want to have those playlists. You can see that these playlists are now completely empty. Always double check your own shit. That's what I'm doing. Let me keep the top 40 stuff there. All right. So that is done. What I now want is I want those new playlists or those edited playlists in my Traktor collection. And for that, we've got yet another app, and that app is named the Traktor iTunes Merge Playlist Tool. The reason for that is because I'll get into the reason while we wait, because it will take some time for it to finish. Here you can see that the iTunes collection or the Traktor collection is found. The iTunes Music Library XML is used, that is automatically produced by iTunes because I use the correct iTunes settings. I can just say start conversion. And what this tool will do is it will show you all the file play. I think it is using a wrong XML. Let me double check that with you. Don't you love live stuff? Because then you see what kind of stuff can go wrong and what stuff can go right. It's a little bit of a mess here, as you can see. And this is the iTunes XML. It's the correct one. And that is the old one. And it's most likely using the old one. So let me do this once again. It's like being a magician. However, this magician knows where the pitfalls are. And now it's using the iTunes library. So we should be good. So that's why I immediately know if I get errors like this, I know, all right, wrong XML. So I'm not panicking, but I can imagine if you use this yourself, what the fuck is going on? Just ask me. I'm always happy to help out. JWG. GWG. It has a good ring to it. JWG. Let me see. No. The thing is, if you disable organizing your tracks, hold on, let me. Let me show that to you. I cannot dive. I should be able to. I can dive in iTunes. That's no problem. This can run while I have opened iTunes and quit iTunes. Because, yeah, it has already. It's all on XML. That's fine. All right. What the JWG is meaning is this. Hold on. Come on. Getting busy on the network, I guess. Oh, what are you doing? Yeah. I've got a hang in iTunes. I never had an eye. Might be that I'm pushing it a little bit too hard to Ah, there we are. All right, what JWG is telling us is he used to have, hold on. Sorry, folks, this is a little bit confusing. I know. I try to do this as good as I can. I needed to update my year mixes. You didn't see me adding to that, but I know that I did add something to it. Need to update our necessities folder because I made some changes there as well. Then go to the top 40 2021 right there, and then I've got the diverse. Hold on, that out once I can. That time once, and then we add these ones. I just do it very roughly because this will be fairly quick once it's started. Got the one, that one, that's still that's on. So basically, you see me just selecting everything that I edited in iTunes. Let's go. Back to JWG's question, because this takes some time. You can see right here that this is off and this is off. However, if you had it on in the past, then the tracks that were moved there in the past will be moved. Only new tracks will not be moved. So JWG, if you add new tracks to your iTunes collection, and a new track means something you downloaded, then they shouldn't be moved to the media folder. So new tracks, old tracks you previously added to the iTunes collection, will still be from your media collection because that's all the iTunes database knows about. Indeed, if you start all over with an empty iTunes collection and an empty iTunes media library, and you still have all your original shit somewhere stored, then you're better off, because then all the file paths will point to your original tracks instead of to the iTunes media folder. But it depends on your setup. Usually I say, because most guys download stuff, throw it in iTunes, and then remove the download, so they don't have the originals anymore. In that case, just stay with iTunes as it used to be. Switch it off for newer tracks, so you manually put them in the correct place. Once you switch it off, iTunes will not bother with it. Long story, it's all about file paths, and iTunes changing file paths to tracks the moment you change metadata, as you saw me just doing with the Houdini track. If I used to use the iTunes copy to media folder option, then I would shift them all over the place and put them in all different file paths. I don't want that. I want them to be static in the place I designate them to stay. That's basically it. So it depends on what you are doing with your collection. But in general, I advise, don't worry about what used to be there, because that will stay there the moment you switch it off, and only new stuff you have to move. If you have the original audio files, then you have duplicates, because you have those original files and you have the files in the iTunes media folder. In that particular instance, I recommend you to just take them away from the iTunes collection and start all over again with the original audio files. In the meantime, while we were talking, Traktor was started. Greg, I don't need the Apple Automator for this. I don't like Automator because it's too restrictive. I use an app named Quicksilver to engage Apple scripts, shortcuts that I created and that come with the iTunes collection tool. I just demonstrated that earlier in the stream. So if you look back, if you take the VOD, the video on demand, and go to the start of it, you see me using it. But I don't like to use Automator because it's too restrictive in what it can do. I rather use Apple Script to tell exactly what I want to do, and then have Quicksilver assigning a keyboard shortcut to it to start it. Hope that makes any sense. Because sometimes it sounds like I'm really talking gibberish here. Let's see if the stuff is there. This one is completely empty, and that is weird, because it shouldn't be empty. Why is that empty? That's not empty. Not empty. This one is empty. Let me maybe my XML wasn't updated, so let me double check. That one is empty too, which is really weird. That shouldn't be empty either. Let me see what's going on, folks, because this is a nice little mystery again. So let's find reason for that mystery. And usually your first start for finding the answer to a mystery is going to the log file. The log file doesn't tell me that anything was missing from whatever we were doing. Double check that indeed the iTunes XML is created, but that should be fine too. Let's see why that didn't come up the way it should be coming up. I should have looked for focus track. Hey Sapio, happy new year, buddy. Yeah, you asked me about Quicksilver. Yeah, Quicksilver is really an excellent tool. I used to use a tool named Quickies, which basically did the same. Quickies was a little bit easier to use. Quicksilver is really geek territory plus, but it's great what you can do with it. It's really helpful. So I recommend Quicksilver if you want to have keyboard shortcuts and invoking them. But I need to find out why my iTunes collection wasn't updated the way it needed to be updated. So let's find out. And there might be several reasons for that. Hold on. There goes nothing. Let's see what's happening there. That's all fine. Then I do something which most of you are afraid of, namely looking inside the iTunes XML folder to see what happened there. And that XML will take some time to open, folks, because it's a big ass XML, as you can see. Close. And let's find, I need a name of something. Oh, Houdini, why not? Houdini, there we are, Houdini. That one. What else do we have? Houdini. Ah, this is of my new one. Volumes terabyte, that all looks fine. That should be no problem to find at all. So let's give this just a try again to see why TIMP is not picking up the new tracks. Of course, that's interesting. That might be the case because the terabyte drive has the wrong name. That's something. Let me double check that. Because that happens if you quickly add and unmount amount new drive or drives to your desktop. So let me see if it's, oh, it's just terabyte. It should be fine too. So I have really no idea, but we are going to find out. Let me just do a very quick test with just Houdini playlist so we know where our exits are before I do everything else. Tapio, I'll be hammering. Let's see. Better touch tool. It's amazing. I've run bash from. I don't know what better touch tool is. Really no idea, but glad if it works for you because whatever works for you is good. So that should be fine. I'm just curious why the heck my stuff didn't make it over to Traktor, because that is fairly important to me. And it should work because it used to work all the time and now it doesn't. I feel like one of the customers or the users of my tools. It always worked and now it doesn't. Why is that mixmasterity? I have no idea. But we will know that in a moment. Most likely because the XML was not updated. But and I did play, of course, a lot with iTunes while process was running. Maybe I shouldn't have done that, helping GWG out with his questions. So that might be a reason. I don't know. Otherwise, I'm going to dive deep into what TIMP does so you can see some of the inner workings. Again, I'm totally open kimono, guys. I don't have any secrets. And there we are, the Houdini, just the Houdini playlist. Well, but the big question is, what is Better Touch Tool doing? Tapio, I really don't know what it is. So if you can quickly throw in the chat what it does, that will be of interest to a lot of users. So please let us know, what is it? What can it do? Because I'm curious too. I have no idea what it's doing or what it can do. So far, so good. So let's wait for it to finish. Always a lot of work, this. If you tell me that you are running a bash from BTT, then you are already telling me that this is going to be above most of the DJ's pay grade, because running bashes is not something that most of them do. Though it can be very, very powerful, that's for sure. Bash script is basically the execution of a couple of terminal commands. So you have the terminal, which is like the MS-DOS prompt for Macintosh users. And that that certainly is a helpful thing. Let's find out what's going on, because I'm so curious what or why didn't incorporate. Normally this is just point, click and go away. This is the easiest part of the whole workflow. And now it's failing me during live stream nonetheless. Why not? Nope, don't need to see it. This updating settings file is kind of like a virus in Traktor. It appears randomly, for no apparent reason. And then all of a sudden it takes forever to start up because it's updating the mysterious settings file. And it will do that for the rest of the for the remainder of the session. So most likely we will have it again. There we are. There we are with the Houdini tracks. So like I told you, most likely there was something wrong with my I should have another playlist. Most likely there was something wrong with the XML, most likely because I was trying to show JWG what he was doing. So let me do that again. You see this folder, analyze these tracks, right there, this one. That is produced by the Traktor iTunes Merge Playlist tool. And why I do that is because I just want to have anything I need to analyze in one particular folder. And because that will be replaced because I have to add the rest of the playlists, I'm going to analyze that right away. And the easiest way is just to say consolidate. Easiest way is to say, hold on, where am I? Oh, where? It's just by selecting the tracks and say analyze. And with parallel processing on. There we go. All right, folks, one thing at a time. These tracks have been analyzed. They've got a BPM, as you can see right there. I can quit Traktor. I'm going to invoke Traktor iTunes merge playlist again, and then I'm going to dive into the various things that are going into on in the chat. Good to see you, folks. It's really nice to have that chat going. That's why I'm doing this, to interact with you guys and to answer whatever you want to answer. Greg, I understand that you want to do this with Automator. However, the problem is that parameters change. And that is why I cannot automate my apps. I automate it as much as possible, but some users will use TIMP without star ratings. Others want to use TIMP without genres. There are various things for various people, and I try to make it a one app fits all with a lot of features you can switch on and off on the fly. The same with TCK, with the Traktor Q and Key tool, which we're going to invoke later on. I cannot put it into Automator. You need to know what was done last. Was it done correctly? Because if it wasn't done correctly, then the parameters change. Were the tracks deleted from the Traktor folder? So much variables that you cannot be aware of using Automator. And indeed, I am with Sapio on this, but I already said that I don't like Automator. It's a very weird way of doing shit, by jumping through three hoops, going back and jump through another hoop, and then finally it can invoke shit. I rather use Quicksilver, and Sapio is telling that basically the tool he is talking about is a bit the same as Quicksilver. So Sapio, can you explain to me why you want to use BTT instead of Quicksilver? Is there something that BTT can do that Quicksilver can't? And that would be of interest to us. Again, it sounds like a tool that is a little bit on the outer edges of the geek spectrum, which I'm fine with, but some of the users, given some of the questions I get, might find a little bit more complicated. AppleScript is not really difficult, Sapio. It is, well, the thing is, I'm programming. I think I program longer than I can write. So it's very natural for me. But AppleScript is a very open, low entry programming language. I really like what you can do with it. More about that later. Let's invoke TIMP, because otherwise we will be here till midnight and I don't care. But I hope that my girlfriend will tell me that I'm invited to have dinner with the girls, because they have their girl night out in the main house. And that's the reason why I'm doing this, just because I'm not allowed to be in the main house, because they are doing girly stuff and I don't really want to be a part of that. All right, here we are again. And let's just launch it. Okay, I understand Sapio. Sapio is telling me, all right, he comes from BTT, so legacy is, he is at home at it and knows what he's doing. And by the way, folks, Quicksilver is not easy to master either, but the iTunes collection tool, which is the main tool that invokes Quicksilver shortcuts, comes with everything baked in. So all you need to do is just download free version of Quicksilver, because settings and everything will be already there. That's something that my tools already do automatically. So that's why I write them, basically, right? Again, like I said, I really like the interaction. You can set Quicksilver triggers with any possible keyboard combination. You don't need to do a shift space first, but you have to be aware that you set the scope of Quicksilver to the particular applications that should be able to trigger the event. Like, for instance, my shortcuts all focus on iTunes and music app. That can invoke a shortcut, just to make sure that you don't trigger those shortcuts outside the realm of that. That's basically the biggest thing you need to keep in mind, but apart from that, it would be good. Here we go again. Then we have the Dance 2020 stuff. Where am I? That. We already did the Houdini stuff, so I don't need to do that again. And let's double check that we are covered. It looks like we are covered. Let's go for it and see what it will do this time around. But I think I found the reason why it didn't do it the first time. I think it's JWG. I blame you for that. No, it's fine. And I see that my connection is stuttering. That the throughput is stuttering. And I'm wondering what is eating away my bandwidth. Because this should be fine. Yeah, that's right. It can be overwhelming. Like I said, these tools are on the geeky side. Wikis was for that much more low-level entry, much easier to master. However, I don't think it's being made anymore. I was using that stuff. yeah, always read the fucking manual. Guys, can someone tell me, is my video delaying? My video slow or going bad, because it looks like I'm stuttering on my preview screen. I don't want that to happen. If that's happening, then I have to make sure that I restart something just to make sure that it is fluid again. So please let me know in the chat if the playback is not as smooth as it was before, or maybe even my audio is stuttering. Let me know. All right. Fine on YouTube. YouTube is by far the hardest part. Then I know what's going on. Most likely the ladies are just. Thank you, guys. It was just. Because I see that happening on my MacBook Air, which I use as a monitor device. But that is on a separate network. And I think the ladies in the big house with their girl party just started to either watch some clips on YouTube, knowing them that somebody, oh, have you seen this video? No, I have. No, show me. And they are eating my bandwidth. So I think that is the case at the moment. And I know I've got the download running, which I probably should have. Done. But if you say that it's still fluid, thank you guys. Once again, thank you for the feedback. Then we just keep it that way, because that should be good. And I can, of course, stop my download. Make sure that it doesn't eat away the rest of the bandwidth. Let me do that. Why not? I'm just waiting anyway. You cannot see me, but I'm now behind my server. And I'm just going to... That's why I like to divide my networks. That one still seems to have pretty, but that's a download stream, not an upload. But this should, there we are. Ah, you see, I'm fluid again. All right. Sometimes things are so easy to fix, aren't they? But I shouldn't forget to open the download again once I'm done with this. But that's why I have separated networks. I have a dedicated network for this streaming stuff. Dedicated network for my servers that handle the licenses and the updates and stuff like that. That is all dedicated networks, just to make sure that they don't conflict and that if there are problems, that I can switch networks. If this network I'm on right now would have a problem, I can switch it to a different network and continue. And because we are all doing this in the cloud, I'm using Restream as my stream provider, basically. It's very easy to just do it like that, so I can very easy switch networks. All right, show me again. There you go. We've got a whole list of analyze me first. You see, those are the new tracks added, and there are some tracks. Ah, that's right. Those are coming. Yeah, that makes sense. That make perfect. Those are the tracks that are new, so I need to analyze them, and let's do that. This and then analyze. with the parallel processing. That question mark coming there. And that. Come on. Did I? No, I didn't. My bad. Now it should work. My tools secretly, because I know that my external drive is a determining factor here. So my tools automatically make sure that the terabyte server is ejected and, if needed, set back the moment that I start Traktor, just to make it faster. And we are going to analyze again. There you can see it analyzing right there. I have to wait for that to finish. I can already put mixed in key to work, which I will do right now. And this is the normal juggling I do, which to some of you might look like, what the shit is going on, because this guy is switching apps and putting stuff all over the place. It's not that difficult, trust me. It's not. Any tracks are an outlier because there we are. So we have them both working, and even I've got all the options off in mixed in key. Mixed in key will still complain that it cannot write to the Traktor NML. I'm happy it at least checks for that, because I don't want it to write at all. So we have to wait for this to finish again. Like I told you, there is a lot of waiting involved. So we just wait and wait and wait. There are some very big tracks or very, very long tracks in that analyzed. Because my year mixes are there. The year mixes are long, so that takes some time. There you can see mixed in key already complaining about the fact that it cannot write to the Traktor Pro collection, which is fine. And I wish I could read what this says, but I can't. It says 54 out of 54, which means we are almost. And we have to. That current check. Analysis up. Come. Can do it. Something going wrong with my Traktor analysis for some reason. Oh no, it's writing. I just was impatient. Just to recap, Sapio, I did, first of all, I started out with converting any cues and loops I set. Why can I? On restream, guys. Ah, it does. Looking at the correct thing. I'm still getting used to this. that's my excuse. You hear that? I did add the tracks. So my first thing was I did add the cues and loops I set on my performance rig. That is right there. The SC6000. I converted that back to Traktor. Then I added the new tracks to iTunes. Adding new tracks also meant that I had to convert some WAV files to MP3. Then I added those tracks to my iTunes collection, all the new downloaded tracks using ICT. Then I had some troubles in getting the new iTunes and the modified iTunes playlists into Traktor. But we fixed that and that's all good now. And now we are working on getting the mixing key cues and keys into the Traktor collection. And that's what's happening now. I just made sure that all the tracks in Traktor, the new tracks, have a grid in Traktor. And I made sure that they were analyzed by mixing key. So basically I can leave Traktor right here. And then we are going to fire up the Traktor Q and key tool to get the information from mixing key in Traktor. And a lot of people ask me, Mixmaster D, why don't you use mixing key to write directly to Traktor? But the reason for that, you will see in a moment, because I do some tricks here. First of all, using TCK, you can add mixing key cues to your existing cue, so it will not wipe everything out and replace it with mixing key cues. But more importantly, to me at least, because I don't give that much about the mixing key cues, I give a zero in front of key values below 10. And I make command fields with zeros in front of values below key value 10 and BPM value 100. So these become sortable. And that gives you a huge benefit when you are working on it. Oh, I'm not. Once again, I am not paying attention. Sorry, folks. Because I was not with this screen on. But here we are. I don't know what you have missed. But maybe something, maybe a lot. I really don't know. But we'll see that in a moment. All right. So this is up and running as well again. They've got my ugly face. And we go to the... Oh, I forgot to make a screen cut of my last newly added track. So this will be a little bit of a guess what to do. But I think I'm good. Ah, I'm good. 108.9. 6.0. Why not? You can see right here that this was the last track that was processed previously. So I just take something off of it and then enter that as the beginning. So there might be some overlap, but that's fine. I just don't want to do 108,000 tracks again. So that's why I edit here. And you can see that I use this shit with real big collections. This is my real collection, folks. This is not something to make jokes about. It is big. And that's why I wrote all my tools, just to keep it sustainable, to keep it manageable, because there's no way in hell you can do this manually with all the duplicate checking involved, etc. Then you cannot do this manually. You can see that the terabyte is again unmounted from my desktop for speeding up Traktor starting up. So I have to make sure that once Traktor is started in the back, you just don't see it there. Yeah, it's very simple. A zero in front of it. I know I'm amazed that the mixing key guys haven't made that possible yet, because it's so simple to implement and can be yet so powerful. And if you look right here, let's see in the comments, where am I? Now you can see that the comments are there. That track is not processed because it's too big. And I don't know why that process really is part of my big collection. These are kind of outliers. I don't really know where they are there. This track is also too big. But the other ones are, there is a question mark involved. Yeah, that might be a problem. That because there is a question mark there, that TCK cannot find them into the mixing key collection. So that makes sense. Still should be possible to get the read the ecosystem there. Okay. Doesn't bring it back. I'm fine with that. Let me first do it like this. And cannot find the track because... Oh, and that's why I check consistency field. You see, I always fall for this. I should modify that it automatically... Now it takes them. Okay. Oh, still no commands there. So it cannot find them in the mixed key database. That's fine. Let's see if we got our queues there. We don't have any queues. Why not? Because those tracks should be there. There are no queues. All kinds of mysterious things are going on right here. So let's find out what's going on here. Oh, nothing there too, so I have to double check what is going on here. You can tell that this is a first time. Very weird, because the commands are all there, but the queues are not there. So let me double check what will be the problem there. Yeah, that's correct, Sapio, but I'm not doing this to make money out of it. That's the reason why price of my tools are so low. I'm not in this thing to make any money. I'm just doing this to help other artists like myself. So that's the reason why I'm doing this stuff. I'm not doing this to make money. So if they fix it, I'm totally happy with that. Saves me some extra stuff. But I want to know why it doesn't take the queues. And I have a slight idea why that might be, because we had, of course, a turn of the year. I think something went wrong with TCK on the NML part. So I want to double check that. Let me double check that, because that means that I have some bugs to fix inside TCK. That's there, and there is my tractor collection. And let me open it. Inside the edit. It'll take some time because, again, this is a big one. And what I'm interested in is the modified date. So let me find, because we still can, a Houdini track. Looks like I tried to modify it. No, cancel, go away. Fine, Houdini, next. That's all of our old stuff coming through there. Let me do it manually, faster. Where am I? That's the end. And there we've got a date of 2021/9. See that there too, you can see that all over the place. That all looks good. So really, I wouldn't know why it couldn't find them in mixed in key, unless it was not in mixed in key. Did I quit mixed in key with it? Tracks have been processed. Same thing as with TIMP. Let's just try it again. See what happens. No, I don't need. What I'm interested in, folks, is this modified date 2021/9. I need to be sure that indeed that is correct. And it is today the 9th. Should be good. So let me do that again. Let me just RTCK again and see what it does with exactly the same parameter I gave them before. That's that. And then I want on settings. Okay, all right, do it again from 1.0. Yeah, the count seems to be right. So, and it did find them. So, I really have no idea what's going on, folks. Let's see. Why not? Yeah, that's true, Sapio, but I did this way before I made them commercially available, my tools. Basically, I had these tools, or kind of, not to the not with the user interface you see right now, and not with the detail, etc., as it is right now. But I already have this for tens of years, because I was doing this always. It was that a lot of artists who saw my workflow and said, hey, we want that too, approached me and asked me for it, and then I thought, why not? I make it available to everybody. But the first time I released this, it was all free, and everybody could just use it for free. But then, if you make something free, you make it worthless, which means people don't invest any time in finding out how it actually works. And that's where the problems began. And my girlfriend, who is a shrink, told me, well, listen, if you want to make this work, you need to have people paying for it. So that's when it became a price on the head for this stuff. Let's see what has happened here. Still no cues, nothing. However, that's what strange about this. I want to have a look inside my ML. See what's going on. Because the keys are there and the queues are not. And you can see by the command field that it has been processed correctly. Oh, once again, we open the NML. And see what's happening. Right. Don't want that. I'll search. On the bed search. What do you mean you cannot find it? Of course you can find it. Should be. Unless I mistype it. Very interesting is happening. There's collection. There it is. There I see my queues. Something else going on here. Because this is not written. Eh? All right. Something very interesting is going on. Where is the end? How closed is that? Oh, hold on, that's right. Looks, folks, that I have some work to do with the TCK due to a new year. Which means, yay, I got work to do. But also means that I'm kind of hitting a hard roadblock here during this stream, because I cannot continue it, because I really want to have that stuff done. So, I'm going to debug some stuff. I just want to have a very quick look. I think... No, that won't work. No, I really need to fix this stuff first, before I can proceed. See what's going on with those mysterious cue is not appearing. I can give it one final shot by adding the tracks. Mixed in key, through iTunes. I see. Indeed, those tracks are analyzed, but they should be analyzed because they've got their keys. There is no way that they can receive their keys without being analyzed. So they're most likely, my guts tell me there is something with the date that needs to be fixed. There's something odd happening with the date in the NML. And that most likely is... Oh, no, this will be fixed, Sapio. Don't worry. I'm not off yet. I just want to try certain things. But you can see right here, everything has been analyzed as was expected. Except for the big mixes. That was expected too. Why not? Let's have a look right here. The TCK database, because then I know what happened. This is how I develop my stuff, folks. This is really, really, really the inside of the inside. There, and it doesn't have any cues there, and it doesn't have cues there. Okay. Let me find command. Oh. Copy it to text. This is how I develop my stuff. Command is there. Let me just clear the commands for everything. Then we know what's going on, or at least we've got a better understanding of what's going on. Back to Traktor. This. Of course, I forgot to connect my drive. This is one of the annoying things. But let's face it, Serato does the same. If Serato finds its database across other drives, it takes forever to start up. Even the moment you mount the drive, then it will close to collapse. Kind of ridiculous. Preparing operation. Let's go. All right, how do you normally do this? Well, you go to the track collection, you sort it on import date, then you make sure that tracks are available. Yes. Top of the collection, it is the top of the collection. And we take all these tracks and we say edit, and you just put a space in the command field to say apply. And that erases all the commands, as you can see, no commands anymore. And then you quit Traktor. That's how you do it. And what I'm interested in is done the same thing. Hold on. Stupid me. I'm falling for my own tricks. I know what's wrong, folks. Nothing wrong with my app. Nothing at all. It's just your basic stupid user error. So I'm going to start up Traktor in a moment when this is done, and I will show you what the problem is. I cannot believe I fall for this track again, but okay, I did. There is no grid. There is no beat grid in Traktor for those tracks. And that is the reason why it is failing. And usually when I'm on my own, I double check my beat grids, because the beat grids are important. The Traktor's beat grids are the best, but still need to check them. So that is what is going on. So let me fire up Traktor once again after it has quitted. Oh boy. Well, you can see this stuff is complicated. Even the man who made it forgets steps in it. And you know, the man who made it even made playlists to show you what needs to be done. And he doesn't look at them, which is totally idiot. But I'll show you in a moment what is wrong. There we are again. Let me mount the terabyte again. I cannot forget. I cannot believe I fall for this one. All right, process tracks. And you see, these should have, by the way, these should have queues. They have, as you can see. Here's the problem, analyzing Traktor. This is the problem. And now you saw me selecting all those tracks and analyze them. I will do that again. However, the grid is off. If I go to the Traktor preferences, I go to analyze options. And you see right here that beat grid when detecting BPM, you see that? And it's not checked. Now it's checked. And this will fix our problem. If I say analyze, and again, this will take a little bit. Man, oh man, this is so stupid. I leave this stream online. I'm not going to delete it. I'm not going to edit it, just to remind myself and to show other users. Don't feel sorry for yourself if you can't get this working, because even the man who created this shit falls for those tricks and forgets to do what is required to do. And especially with this one, this is a hard to find one usually. And the first thing I always yell to people who ask me, oh, TGK is not giving me the cues, etc. Is the track analyzed? Is there a grid? Because that is always the problem. But you saw me falling for it as well. The reason why it didn't have a grid is most likely, remember, I told you about that appearance of checking preferences or something like that, or settings, or checking settings, or fixing settings. That will trigger the set beat marker if you if detecting BPM, that will trigger it off, and that will make a huge problem. So that's the reason why this is not working, was not working. We'll be fine now, so we are totally on track to get this show on the road again. Man, I cannot believe that I fall for that. So stupid, but okay, why not? In the meantime, while we are waiting, not in the meantime, there is no meantime right now. That's it. I'm going to eject the terabyte. Let me do this properly now. Eject it, and let's stop Traktor and then eject it. Then I don't need to eject, because we're going to run TCK again, and then we will be fine. So now this will be pretty quick, folks. Now this will be pretty snappy, because this is the part of the workflow that never has any issues, unless you forget the rules. I did, obviously. Now I need a new water. The secret stash of water. That's just plain old me. Always overthinking stuff. Not going for the most obvious. And that is just, if you develop these kind of apps, that is the way you are wired. That's the way you will work. Warned you guys, Traktor takes close to forever if you have it mounted. All right, that is all done. Fire up TCK. We can dream this now, right? Don't forget to set the advanced range, because you need that. Otherwise, it's going to do everything. I don't want it to do everything. Oh, 108960. Go back to the main settings and let's go. Sit back, keep your fingers crossed. we should be there in shortly. And then we didn't even import it in Rekordbox yet, because that takes ages as well. But while that is running, we have some stuff running concurrent to it. So that's the better part of it. And again, if you've got questions, folks, dump them in the chat. What the chat is for. And thank you for standing by with me, because I warned you, this is boring. This can be so boring. I cannot believe it, how boring it can be. But if you master it, that can be so great. All right. Now you can see it has a 2B key. Those are tracks that were not found inside the database. And this one in there. No idea. And this is all processed. But if you do it from a playlist perspective and load something up and you mount the drive there on, don't you love that? Then you will see that the cues are indeed there. As expected. Looks like somebody's. So that's all there. That's all working. So we are good to go on to the next phase. Let me remove those playlists because they serve their purpose. And I always like to delete them just to make sure that the moment they appear, that they need to be worked with. If they don't appear, that means we are good. Good. Double check. Most likely that has a dynamic grid. Doesn't have dynamic grids. In the meantime, that they would be there, but they are not there yet. That folder. So my Traktor collection is nice and tidy, and I can export the collection to an NML. Always make sure that you switch this one off, or you will be sitting there forever. And then we are on our way to convert, finally. It's always, this is always the part that you have to be patient, because this stuff is slow. There's nothing I can do about it. This is a fast computer. This is a huge collection, of course. And if you're watching this, then it's like watching paint dry, watching grass grow. It is slow as hell, but yeah, you have to wait for it to finish. And never be afraid if you see that beach ball with this kind of activity. Traktor is notorious for it, but you saw the same thing happening with iTunes a moment ago, that iTunes will give you the spinning beach ball. You think, why? Why is that spinning beach ball? But basically that is because something is happening, or it's doing something. I should be ejected. That, by the way, was a little trick how you unload a track in Traktor. Just switch it to the remix decks and switch it back. Then I could eject my terabyte, which you can see is fairly quick. But while it's doing that, I don't have to wait for it, because we can fire up the DJ conversion utility. Yay, finally. We thought it would never happen, Master G. No, neither did I. And we tell it we want to go from Traktor. We want to have the modified at or after January 1st, 2021. And we tell it to start conversion and just sit back and wait while Traktor is still. Oh, hold on, this won't work, because next Master G, you are such a loppy person today. Let me see, I can still force quit it, but I don't think I voice can give it a try, right? We can, because I need the tracks to be available. So if I do that, without the tracks available, then everything goes wrong. You see, I want to take shortcuts, but it doesn't always fly. But now it does. We go from Traktor and we want to have it modified after the January the 1st. And we say, let's go. And what's happening here, folks, is basically I instructed the DJ Converse utility to take every track that was modified after January 1st and put it into one big playlist in Rekordbox. Why one big playlist in Rekordbox? Because I don't use playlists in Rekordbox, I use them in iTunes. So even in Rekordbox, I use the iTunes playlists. You'll see that in a moment. I really ask myself why this count is 520. It should be much less, but it is what it is. Most likely it wanted to change something, or it saw some tracks that were changed. Metadata is changed, and the modification date will change. But it's still better than 110,000 tracks, that's for sure. We have to wait for this to finish. You can see this goes fairly quick. Oh, it might be the I know what which tracks are changed. And it's right about that. So, and argue with logic, and this is perfectly logic. So 520 tracks it is. That means that the Rekordbox XML import will take ages. It will be very, very slow. But while that is running, we can do other things. Basically, I can finish my entire workflow, and Rekordbox XML is still importing. But that's fine with me. It's just the way it how it works. Man, you have to be patient with this, right? And it's always fun to watch it. Again, folks, just drop your questions in the chat if you just want to ask me questions. If there's something on your mind, you're not sure how something works, just drop it in the chat. I'm more than happy to help you with it or answer it for you. And here we go, Rekordbox. No need to see the log. Rekordbox is started. You will see something interesting happening because Rekordbox will start analyzing right away. Out of the gate. And that is because we did add some tunes in iTunes. Not analyzing yet. To be in expert mode, that it is. And we go to the sync manager. By the way, this is Rekordbox 5.6.0, folks, due to the Rekordbox XML import bug. I synchronize with the iTunes playlists and I want to have all playlists. So just trigger that and then click the big arrow. And you can see 81 tracks needs to be imported in Rekordbox. The rest is already there. These are from old imports I did, so I can remove them. That playlist, yep, that one. Delete this one. No playlists at all. However, if we go inside here, you can see that all the playlists are there. And even our brand new playlist, right there, is there with only the tracks that were added to Rekordbox. It should find more. So the question is, why didn't you find them? Invoke the sync manager again. Let's see. Oh, we know where. No, it's online. Should be good to go. Let me refresh the XML then. Because it should have a longer list with tracks that are not yet analyzed. No, it doesn't find. Why not? various things are going on in the world of record box here. My dump is empty, it shouldn't be empty either. Very weird. Let's make sure that the record box is looking at the correct record box XML, shall we? I think it is looking at this one. But just to be sure, let's point it to it again. Close it out. Refresh it. It is analyzing tracks, analyzing two tracks. Should be analyzing much more. This is not good, folks. I've seen this happen before, but no, and again. Switch it on again. It is on. Why is it on again? Of course, the count looked good to me, so it should take the correct playlist. All right, let's see what's happening there. Also, I've got a slight feeling that Recordbox is not looking at the correct. That one is there. That one is there too. I see it's analyzed, but nothing there. Double check in the iTunes playlist then. Because we all know there should be quite a few tracks in 2021 playlist like this. Those are not there. Just give it a shot and we go to the Recordbox XML. And then we soon enough find out what went wrong there. Because let's take a track from that top 40 list just as a test track to see if everything went right. That is already there. The Disco Dive. Why not? It's Dutch. Excuse, we load up. This will take a while because it's coming from the XML part. Like I said, the XML part is slow. There we are, and you can see it has the queues indeed. As expected, converted to Recordbox queues. That means the Recordbox XML is good. So let's take it from the top and just only interested in ones with folks. Can I import it on queue? Yeah, we can. No, we can't. Don't you love that? All right, everything just import to the collection. Let's go. And that one is off to the races, as you see. This stuff. That means that we can hide Recordbox because, like I said, this is really, really slow. We fire up the DJ conversion utility because I want to have all this information in all my other DJ software. So that means we are going to Serato, we are going to Virtual DJ, and we're going to DJ. But before I go to DJ, I want to make sure that the tracks are analyzed in DJ. In order to do that, we have our faithful dump playlist. Put the top 40 tracks in it, or basically what I easier can do is go from the songs. Just take everything that is new there. Yes. Hold on. This entire lot. And we just put it inside dump. That. So those tracks are not in DJ most likely. You also see that the comments are not correct in iTunes. And that's one of the things that a lot of people ask me about. That is because iTunes is not real time. The comments in the audio files are correct. However, iTunes haven't touched the audio files. So the moment I play a track, you will see that the comment will change. See that? It will change automatically. And I made a script for this. If you select all the tracks there and you invoke the script right there, refresh select text, then you see that all the comments will be there. So that's a little thing that TCK installs. It does it for the music app and it does it for the iTunes app, as you can see. The Rekordbox tune key tool, the Rekordbox equivalent of TCK for Rekordbox, does the same thing. It will install that same script into your script menu so you can refresh your selected tags. Trust me, you want to do that. Then I fire up my DJ and I have to double check that my current DJ library is up and running, because some of you might know I've done quite some development for DJ lately, which means that I've been going back and forth with my DJ collection a lot. So I just want to make sure that my big collection is live and online for DJ. And in the meantime, Rekordbox is still doing its shit, and we will double check that in a moment. In DJ, I go to the playlist, and if you press this symbol, that means you go to the playlists. We don't check if the 2021 playlist in. This is how it's supposed to be. So it's a Rekordbox, and most likely, if I restart Rekordbox, one of those serious things in Rekordbox you need to know about. I select the playlist, which all tracks were added to the collection, remember, and just say analyze in DJ. Again, tracks need to be analyzed before they can receive converted cues and loops, stuff like that. So that's why I'm analyzing those tracks away. That saves me a lot of time, because otherwise I need to run the DJ first, fire it up and run it, and we will be fine. You can also see that the star ratings are there, the comments are there, everything is there. So all I need to do is start the conversion. Keep in mind, we come from a Traktor collection that was converted to a Rekordbox XML. Rekordbox XML is the base for all my apps. It's the spider in the web, is what everything works from. So I say I come from a Rekordbox XML. I want to go to Serato, I want to go to DJ, I want to go to Virtual DJ. Right here you can see the Rekordbox DDSU XML is used as the source XML. And this will be fairly quick, by the way, because all the heavy lifting and complex stuff has already been done. The encoders are known, they are in the ICT database. Everything is done, so basically we just say we want to convert that playlist. Sit back, relax, and watch it work. This, by the way, this part has been updated in the new DJ conversion utility as well. It should be much faster for people who used it in the past than it was before. And just, you can wait for it, as you can see. It was fairly quick, used to be very slow. There was some code optimization I could do there. So I did it, because I want this to be as quick as possible and efficient as possible. And this is all real time, folks, because this is a live stream. Yay, it's a live stream. You see, this is all very, very quick. Given to DJ, and then all those apps will be opened while in the back iTunes is still working. Adding tracks to DJ or to iTunes is for the tracks that were not found in the DJ collection, and that is most likely because they have weird characters in their file path or in their title or in their name. But that might be a problem. The 12 tracks were not found. I will see about those tracks, why they were not found in DJ. First about it too. But it might also, they might be out of the scope of the new tracks. That's most likely the case. Here we are. First of all, in Serato. This is DJ, and this is Virtual DJ. Let's take this one track at a time. Yes, I know. Go away with that. And then right here we go to this playlist, because that's all the new stuff. Let's find iets met duivel. There we are. The Disco Duivel. And we load it up, and you can see that the cues are appearing right there. We're not 8 cues there. That means I'm good in Virtual DJ. I can quit Virtual DJ. My shit is all there. Exit. Then we are in DJ, and in DJ we had this thing produced called the DJ. Where is it? Don't see it in DJ. That's weird. That's most likely because iTunes is still open. Let me quit iTunes and let me reopen DJ manually in a moment. Right here we've got inside the DJ conversion utility right there. Our 1.1.2021 playlist. Where am I? There am I. And then let's find the same Disco Duivel track. And it got used there. Let's double check one of the Houdini tracks. Why not? And it got cues as well. But those cues most likely are shifted because it is an analog recorded track. Actually, it comes from my vinyl, so the rip might be a little bit shady. That's fine. So Serato is good too. And then what is left is DJ. Close out a couple of apps there. Let me. You can see we are already done with 35 tracks in Racketbox. I fire up DJ again just to see which tracks were missing from the previous conversion, and then I might just run the conversion again. Depends on what kind of tracks it are. Because I was missing this one, and that was because iTunes was not quitted yet. This makes sense that it can't find it. I don't see anything that is very important to be there. So make sure that they are analyzed, and they are right now, and then with it and leave it there. That means my base stuff is all converted. And we go to Denon Prime, because I want to have my Denon Prime performance drive, the drive that I usually connect to. Close that. Once again, I told you. Oh, I'm working with the wrong mouse. But yeah. That was what I wanted to show you guys, but it will not switch my overlay. Let me. Things you can do if you use web services. You see that? All right. So there is my Denon Prime gear. And I want to make the drive that has all my collection on it for the Prime gear ready as well. So let me find that. This is that drive. This is a master drive. And I cloned this to all the performance drives. It's a 2 terabyte SSD. So this should be fairly quickly. The longest part will be taken for sure by backing up the collection that is already there. Like this. And then let's fire up the collection backup tool. There it is. And the collection backup tool will also work again from the same DGCU XML right there. That is still that Traktor to Racketbox XML that is still importing in Racketbox, but already being converted to Virtual DJ, to Serato, and to Algorithms DJ. That's the same XML. And the collection backup tool will basically copy all the tracks that are not on the Prime drive or are modified since the last time they were backed up to the Prime drive, and then it will start the Denon conversion utility to convert the data for those tracks. And as you can see, this again goes quickly. Only for the backup part. And again, folks, if you've got questions, if you have stuff you want to ask that is on your mind, just drop them in the chat. That is the reason why I'm doing this. You can ask me anything about collection management and conversion or macOS technical questions. And I try to help you with it wherever I can. I don't make any guarantees. And man, I can imagine that this is boring stuff to watch. If you are watching it from the beginning, power to you. Because I'm sure I couldn't make that to the end. But I make this kind of thing, or I do this kind of things just to show you what can go wrong. And to give you an indication of what is possible. Because this is pretty powerful stuff, as you can imagine. Because it saves you so much time. I don't have to set queues in Serato at all. I set them either in Traktor, or I set them on the SC6000, and then I convert it all to Serato, same with DJ. Don't set any queues there at all. That might change. I might tweak my workflow a bit, that I use an iPad Pro, to set queues and loops in tracks for DJ, because I can now convert back from DJ to Traktor. So that might be becoming part of the workflow, especially if I'm weeding out the automatically set mixed in key queues, because some of them are useful but others are not so useful. So that all depends on what I want to do. So that might be something that will be involved inside the workflow later on, and we have to wait for this to finish. I'm just making up conversation with you that you're not totally bored to death. I'm still waiting for the actual conversion to kick in, because still making the backup. And that backup is made every 24 hours. So if the backups are older than 24 hours, it will create a new backup. And because this is still that same 108,000 tracks big collection, that database, those database files are huge. Give you an indication about what we're talking about. Where am I? Library. There it is. And let's go to size. You see, 20 gigabyte is now a small database, and that needs to be backed up. So that is something that will take some time, but you will be so happy once that is done, because if you run into trouble, very quickly or very easy to recover from those troubles. So that's basically the reason why I do it. Just to make sure that you have a backup. And all my tools, by the way, always make automatic backups, because I find it very important that there's always a way to restore whatever is done. It's not always possible with everything my tools can do, but most of them make backups in one way or the other. I'm still waiting for this to finish. You have to be patient. And lucky enough, I am.
The Denon conversion utility needs your attention.
You see, there we are. And Engine Prime is automatically started. This is the mandatory stage mid-procedure where tracks that are new to the Engine Prime collection need to be analyzed. And why do I need to be analyzed? Why do they need to be analyzed? Simple, because otherwise you run the risk that the converted data is overwritten. is overwritten by the analysis data. So we analyze the tracks. This is, by the way, the beta I'm on, beta 1.6, the public beta, which no longer has the possibility to quit it and then have the pull down menu quit when done. So I have to physically be here, wait for it to finish. You can see right there that everything has now a preview, which means is analyzed, which means we can quit it. Yes, we want to quit it. And then the Denon conversion utility will do the actual conversion, which is rather quick because there were not many tracks in the conversion. Switch that off. I really hate that automatic thingy there. The information. And once again, it's reading the drive. Take some time. It take a lot of time. What you folks, big collections take a long time. But it will get there eventually. I can quit Quicksilver because I don't need it anymore. This is taking too long for my taste, which means we force quit it and start it again. Because usually that is an indication that something went wrong with engine prime. 3, 2, 1, hit it. Let's do it again. And something went wrong because it's adding the information thingy back too. So what is it doing? Upgrading database, we don't need that, we don't need that. Resetting the streaming databases, really don't want that. That looks like my engine prime preferences are seriously screwed up. So let me just cancel everything it is doing, cancel all. Then tell it. This should be off, this should be off, that should be off, that should be off. Dropbox is fine. Or somehow it's doing something on the prime drive and it doesn't want to say what. This is really one of those streams, folks. I love it. Let me force quit it. What is going on there, folks? Ejecting it and remounting it. That usually does the trick. Engine Prime is a weird beast sometimes, so. I need to know, like Record Box, about its habits and why things sometimes don't work the way you expect it to work. Look! That's all better, isn't it? So, I hope you learned something from this, folks. Don't panic. Just stick to the program. And that ugly thing is on again. Now, these tracks were not analyzed. Oh, they didn't have. That's fine. We've got right here the playlist with our new tracks. There we've got the Houdini tracks. You can see that they received their cues right there. We go to the more modern tracks with our favorite. Right. Oh, you cannot search in. That's also one thing. You cannot search inside a playlist. You always search into the whole collection. Now, I want to find the Duivel track again, but I forgot Disco Duivel. That was the. There we are. So that's converted as well. So that's all good. Now here you think, hey, Mixmaster G, but you have this playlist all tracks modified at or after. You don't want to have that playlist. And indeed, I don't want to have that playlist. I want to have the iTunes playlists. And for that, it's the final stage of our whole journey. It has been a journey, that's for sure. We're going to start up the collection backup tool again. And this time we are going to feed it the iTunes XML. Right there, and we start the backup. This is doing the same thing as before, but because the tracks in the record box collection in the XML, if you like, and the iTunes are the same tracks, this will go fairly quick, and you can see that already. It will be fairly quick. The only reason I need to do this is because I need an iTunes XML, a description of my iTunes collection on the Prime drive, because that will give you me the possibility to create the playlists from iTunes in Engine Prime, and then I'm done and I can have dinner. Yay! Looking forward for that. And I can see that a lot of people thought, well, Mixmaster G, we believe it. We believe this stuff works. You have more patience than us. We are leaving you with it. I can totally understand that. I really can. But I'm not the guy who gives up easily, so if I start something, I really want you guys to see it from the start to the end. So that's what I'm doing right here, just showing you that indeed it can be done and that it is highly efficient, because it might take some time, but on the other hand, can you imagine how much time you save by doing this all automated? It's incredible. Looks like some things were changed actually outside since I last run this, because this should be already done. But that seems to be the theme of this stream, that hey, it used to work quicker, different, better. And then I come to the conclusion, all right, it's something I did, but fair enough. We have that fixed. And remember, this is a big collection. We are talking about a huge collection here. Just waiting for the final steps of it, because at the end of this procedure is where the copying actually takes place, where the real copying needs to be done, because those are the tracks not in the collection yet. Rest is fine. And I need to do something else in Engine Prime before we can restart it, but the Denon conversion utility will not automatically be invoked, so I can do that manually as well. I can do that right. Of course, I want to clear my necessities. Containment, great. Due to some changes I've made. This crate right here, I want to recreate completely from scratch, so I will remove it. Continue. And remember, deleting a crate, deleting a playlist, doesn't delete the track. It tracks, it contains, it only deletes that particular playlist. That's exactly what I wanted to do. I want to do the same thing with the... Of course, you cannot batch. Select them, why not? Remove. CBT is done. Dead. Continue. Remove. Continue. All right. The reason why I do this is because the next step in the Denon conversion utility will recreate those crates, but it will add tracks to those crates if those crates already exist. So that means that if tracks were replaced by newer tracks, you will have obviously duplicate tracks or tracks not found in that list, and I don't want that to happen. So that's why I do that already. You see right here that the IGSMUS library on the prime drive is selected as a source in Denon conversion utility, and that's exactly what I want. I want the protection to be basically enabled because, oh no, let's disable it. I'm not sure what it found, but maybe there are some commands that were updated or needed to be updated. For that reason, I have the protection disabled, but usually you can run this with protection enabled. It's just that I did some very special things here, which I want to be sure that are indeed done. Once again, this is the have a little bit of patience part, because it takes some time to get all the playlists out of iTunes, especially my big playlists with a lot of tracks. Those takes a long time to get out of iTunes. That's what you are seeing right now. And if you are new to the stream, we are in the final stage of my entire workflow, which means I've shown what I do if I download new tracks or I have made modifications to tracks, setting new cues, setting new loops, how I go about that, what I do to get that throughout all the DJ software I use and on all the devices I use. What you won't see me doing in this particular stream is making a CDJ USB, basically because I've got a tutorial for that, and that's pretty straightforward. It's just using Rekordbox, pointing to the drive that you are going to hook to the CDJ, and that will be it. So that's very easy stuff, but especially this Denon stuff is very, very efficient, but a little bit out of the box. So that's why I want you to see it. You fully understand how this works, and you can do this at home if you like to. All my tools are available for everybody who wants them or needs them. I want to have the necessities folder. Remember, that's that folder I just deleted. And then we go to the those ones. Forget anything. We didn't forget anything. Then we go to the Houdini one. And go to the 40/2021. I press the command key when I click them, which means that I see everything previously is still selected as well. So I made a very particular selection from my entire playlist, from my entire iTunes collection. And you can only do that with my stuff. That is that you can do it incremental, and that you can point, all right, I want that playlist, I want that playlist folder, I want that playlist. And just make a combination of the stuff you want to have, in this case, in Engine Prime. That's rather unique for my tools to be able to do that. This will take some time. I find my SSD drive a little bit slow. Okay, it should be much quicker, but probably has its reasons. And of course, as always, folks, if you've got questions, put them in the chat. The chat is open. I can see your questions right here. So if you drop them, just let me know. I'm happy to answer them or address them however I can. Next week, or this week's actually, coming Tuesday, I will do a stream, and that stream will be about audio formats for DJs. I will deep dive into the various audio formats, what is an audio format, and why I stand by using MP3s and nothing else. I will show you how I do it. I will tell you why I do it that way, and maybe not to convince you, because basically your workflow is your workflow, and if you're happy with it, that's a good workflow. But just give you my reasoning why I do the stuff I do, and maybe it helps you improve your own workflow, or maybe it makes you feel completely content about your current workflow, because like I said, it's your workflow. It's your thing to judge if it's correct for you or not. And let me finish some stuff on the other screen while we are all waiting for this to finish. I know you should have music running here, but why would you have music running on anything else but Twitch? Your stream will be killed, and we are live on YouTube, on Twitch, and on Facebook right now. And that seems to be pretty steady, so I want to keep it that way. And that's the reason why I'll just stick to it. And the SSD is slow today. Could be so much faster than this, but well, we'll see. Hold on tight, that's the motto. Man, I've seen faster race than this. Maybe I shouldn't have deleted the necessities folder, but I really wanted to be that one to be rebuilt from scratch. And usually when I'm not streaming this, I'm just walking back and forth and using it, or even developing my apps or debugging or whatever I have in mind. There is basically never a moment that I'm standing here and waiting for this stuff to finish, other than when I'm sharing it with you guys. So I hope you appreciate it, because it always feels like a huge waste of time if you have to do that. And if you edit it out, of course, you can just cut it up and then show it. But we at the ATGR production team folder, or production team videos, are not about cutting videos. We are just open kimono. We show you everything there is to see. The dirty truth, if you like. And that's, it is what it is. And we are approaching the final stages. All of this. Don't you love it? Sounds like watching a movie, but then a very bad one. A boring one. You have these movies that they make during the lockdown, and they make movies using Zoom. This is one of those movies, those Zoom movies. And I'm sure nobody is going to watch this in the cinema. But the benefit is, if you're watching this from VOD and you forward it to, I guess, 9:11, it's now 9:08, as you can see at the clock at the top of the screen. If you forward to 9:11, we should be fine, and you can see the final results, which is always a joy, of course. Can you imagine that people are watching other people unboxing stuff and things like that? And that never caught on with me. Why would I watch anybody unboxing anything? Just show me the stuff. I'm too pragmatic for that, I guess. I just want, all right, this is the box, and this is what is in it. Not how you cut it open, all the extra wrapping that is around it. Really couldn't care less. Well, this is that same thing, but then with the DJ twist. It's just unwrapping, but nothing is to be unwrapped. It's just waiting until it's finished. And I did guess 9:11 would be the time. Right here, you can see it. And I think I might be right, because we are approaching the final stages. That was a very weird voice. And folks, just tuning in, this is my real workflow. This is what I do if I have downloaded new tracks for my various record pools. In this particular workflow, you can see it at the beginning of the stream. If I did some vinyl rips of stuff I found out was not in my collection at all. And I'm really ashamed of that because it was Houdini who wasn't in my collection. Who can have a collection without Houdini in it? So I really needed to do that. And I show you what I, how I get that all my collection and what I do. Right, we are through. We are going to fire up Engine Prime. There's Engine Prime again. And let's dive into the stuff all the way. Maybe it's a bit bigger. Yay, everything is there. You can see the cues there. And then we can test this folder. I go to the dance mix selection because that will tell me most. And that was what I wanted to know. That's there as well. Then there is some stuff in the hip hop that I change. Because this track, it won't say much to you guys, but it's a Dutch hip hop track by de Jeugdvertegenwoordig. And that's there too. Nice. All right, so I'm good with that one as well, which means I am done. I am finally done. I have all my stuff on my Denon Prime. And again, this is my master drive. This is the, I always have a master drive. And what I always like to do is give each player its own performance drive. This is P1, that's performance drive one. And the fastest way to get that done, I'm not going to do this all again. What I just do is using the carbon copy cloner. If you don't know about carbon copy cloner, Google it. It is an incremental backup tool. And I want to start my, first of all, my internal backup, because all my collections have changed. So I want to have those changes backupped internally. You can see that that is backing it up internally. That's my startup drive. Then we've got the terabyte EP. And that is basically the backup from the prime drive. You see the source already selected right there. And what I will do is I will connect. Oh, I cannot do that. I cannot do that because the USB 3 port is right now occupied by the cam I'm looking in right now. So that's not possible. Trust me, I will just run the carbon copy cloner with the prime. That's just 5 minutes. And then that very big drive I just prepared will be distributed to my other drives. What else can I tell you, folks? I think I'm pretty much done. Let's see how far Recordbox is with the import. Remember, that was the import I started. And you can see that will take quite a while before it is finished. So we are not going to wait for that. I thought I already... Now I quit it here. And that also means that I'm about to leave you guys. Those of you who stick with me from the beginning, thank you very much for your confidence and thank you very much for sticking with me. If you got questions, this is the final call for questions in the chat. Otherwise, I will be here again this Tuesday, 7 o'clock p.m. European time. That is Paris time or Berlin time or Amsterdam time, whatever you like. 7 p.m. Central European time. The subject of the next stream will be audio files for DJs. It will be a deep dive, especially in all the myths that are surrounding MP3 files, because there are quite a lot of myths doing the rounds about that. And there is some stuff you need to know about it. So I will address that. Other than that, I hope you all will have a wonderful weekend. Thank you for hanging out with me. If you like what I'm doing, don't forget to like and subscribe and tell your friends, your DJ friends, about that I'm doing this kind of stuff. For now, thank you for watching. Mixmaster G, signing off.